What do all these faces have in common? What do all faces have in common? Fear of God. Fear of God. We don't even realize it. We're so afraid we don't even discuss it. We don't even talk about it. We don't even realize that we've put up massive defenses against this. But it is possible. The spiritual path is basically recognizing that there's absolutely no reason to fear God whatsoever. That is what the spiritual path is all about. And you can gauge your progress in that way. And I can speak of this. I've recently had so much progress that I can feel the absence of fear of God. It's just not there. Able to be very positive instead of negative and defensive about it. In fact, all of these faces are just masks. It's all the same face. It's the face of fear. All the same face, the face of fear. And we don't need to be fearful. There's no cause for fear whatsoever. No cause. We're just assuming that there's a cause. Buddha said that ignorance is the cause of all suffering. We're ignorant. And the spiritual path gradually dissolves this ignorance, dissolves the fear, and to the point where one can take on the face of non-judgment. It can be called forgiveness if you want to, but it's really face of non-judgment. That is that God doesn't judge dreams at all. This is the saving information that removes your ignorance. God does not judge dreams at all. No judgment upon them. God just affirms that the dreamer is perfect and is flawless. Eternally perfect, eternally flawless. Simply just reaffirms that. See, it's the dreamer that counts, not the dreams. The content of the dreams doesn't matter. The fact is that dreams do not affect the dreamer at all. We use the body to try and manufacture evidence that the dream is affecting the dreamer because we insist that the body is the one doing the dreaming. The brain, the body is doing the dreaming. It's not true. The mind is doing the dreaming, and the mind is not a product of the body. It's vice versa. So all these bodies are just false manufactured evidence that dreams affect the dreamer. But what God reassures us is that dreams don't affect the dreamer at all. Imagining what ifs don't affect the one who is entertaining the what if. Even when we say, well, what if we could be affected by what ifs? That still doesn't affect the what ifer. Dreams don't affect the dreamer, but bodies, we look at bodies and say, oh my gosh, look how the dream is killing these bodies. And we're afraid, like, oh, the dreams are affecting the dreamer. Well, the body is not the dreamer. It's just a device, a symbolic device we're using to scare ourselves. The central fact is that God does not judge dreams at all. Doesn't even pay any attention to them. This is a different way of looking at the situation, and it definitely leads to your losing your fear of God, which then leads to willingness to accept the non-judgment of all dreams, which leads to bliss. Non-judgment of dreams is bliss. And then you have a different face then. It's a different face altogether. not these faces. Okay, you can tell. If there's bliss there, there's bliss there. It's not happiness. It's not contentment. It's not anything like that. It's bliss. It's non-judgment. It's shining. There's a shining purity and freedom, knowing that God's judgment was concurrent with time, with the rising of all dreaming. Now is concurrent with time. The now of non-judgment is concurrent with time, arising at the very same moment of dreaming, and always with dreaming, not judging it at all, no judgment, non-judgment, not needing any judgment upon it whatsoever. So it's already taken place. The last judgment was the first judgment, because it's never going to change. It's just one judgment upon all dreams, both ones that we're aware of and ones we're not aware of. Any dream content whatsoever, perfect non-judgment upon all of it, eternally. So the judgment is not something that has yet to transpire. We're not waiting for it. It took place concurrent with the beginning of time, at the same instant. This very same instant. So it's already taken place and will never be altered. So it's not anything that we have to work towards or to earn. It's not something that has yet to take place, and then we're trying to get a good judgment or get a certain type of judgment. No, it was concurrent with the very beginning of dreaming, of what ifing, and judgment. The perfect non-judgment remains with all dreams, all what ifing, all hypotheticals, all imagining, eternally, no judgment. So we don't have to earn it. We don't have to do anything. It's already there. And we can't lose it either. Nothing we can do is going to change that non-judgment. Nothing at all. Nothing we can dream can change that non-judgment upon dreams. Nothing at all. So this is when this begins to sink in, you find your fear of God evaporating. And then you realize, wow, I really can be enlightened. I really can be free. It's absolutely possible, and it's actually, you can realize it's going to happen for you, because you simply can get to the point where you accept the non-judgment upon all dreaming. And then we don't have to use our bodies to manufacture false evidence that dreams affect the dreamer. Don't have to. So it's a great time in the world right now. It's a great time. It's really a great time, because it's going, the tide is getting very low. Very, very low tide. Let's make an adjustment here. One moment, please. All right. The situation is getting more and more boiling of course. And yet that is the greatest opportunity for us, for we are able to focus in on what's truly important now and realize the rest of the stuff, forget it. Forget about it. Either we're afraid of fear God or we don't. We're going to decide which way to go. Are we going to maintain our fear of God, or are we going to set that down with a laugh and say, ah, that was incredibly silly. What a funny, funny whim that was. So I'm here to tell you that it is very possible to go that way. I can certainly say that I have gone that direction and will continue in that direction and will at some point set down that fear altogether. And it won't be part of my experiencing anymore. So this is the time when we make the decision, make the choice. So again, that is a great opportune time, because collectively there's pressures being brought to bear, which is basically saying, hey, who's going to be the sheep and who's going to be the goats? Who's going to be the wheat and who's going to be the chaff? And we get to make our own decisions on that. We get to say yes to putting down the fear of God, setting it down. And there's been some bizarre defenses. I can tell you this, being in the world and studying the whole situation here, been able to really decode it all, take a look at it all, and see just how foolish and convoluted some of the defenses are. Amazing, amazing stuff. But it's been seen through. It's been seen through how we're able to come up with some bizarre defenses and then institutionalize those bizarre defenses against the fear of God and be so grateful that we were tipped off that God is this murderous, crazy tyrant wanting to kill us, and we've been tipped off about it. So now we can make doubly sure we keep hiding and trying to make this world a hiding place, a permanent hiding place for us, and all this nonsense. Just a sad and unnecessary and ignorant. And it is entirely possible to see through this delusion, this fear of God, which is just completely unfounded. It's really based on our desire to unseat God. It's not based on God's desire to change anything. It's our desire to change things. It's our desire to attack. It's our desire to do all this. And yet, it has no effect in reality. So there's no cause for any upset from God, none whatsoever. Our belief that God is angry at us is just our whim to think that we can affect reality, change reality, threaten reality. We cannot at all. And it is very possible to see through all of this if one continues the path. Ramana Maharshi said that the path requires great effort, and anyone who finally succeeds because of perseverance. That's it, because of perseverance. That's the good news. It's not luck, it's perseverance. Which means any one of us can do it, right? If it was luck, how would that be good news? It'd be terrible news. We say, well, someone's just lucky. That's the worst news possible. Because then we say, my gosh, what if I'm unlucky? How do I get lucky? I don't know. It's just horrible. But if we hear that it's simply the result of perseverance, right effort, perseverance with right effort, then we can say, wow, I can do it. I can do it too. There's nothing stopping me. That's my path. That's what I have taken. And I always felt that it was simply a matter of right effort. And that would succeed if it's just simple perseverance. Just persevere with right effort and that will succeed. So I felt like, you know what? It's in my hands. It's under my control. I have the key to unlock the door. And that's simply perseverance. Anyone can do it. That is a great, great, great message. Nothing's stopping anyone from doing it. Nobody can stop you. You simply get up in the morning and you make as much effort as possible during the day to whittle away the fear of God. Because the non-judgment is already there. It's always been there, shining for us. And we need to get to the point where we embrace it and say, yes, 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 that's exactly what I really want. I have no fear of that. That's wonderful. I accept that. Non-judgment upon all content of dreaming, regardless of any of the content of the dreams, any of the form that the dream takes, doesn't matter at all. And that's eternal non-judgment. No matter what happens in the future, no matter what happened in the past, all the same, the non-judgment will be the same. So just think of the stability that brings to your experiencing. Perfect stability. And the only thing standing in your way is simply your own laziness. That's it. That is it. Nothing else. So that is a profoundly great gospel to share. Only your laziness stands in the way, which you have control over. Because you can decide minute to minute, am I going to be lazy or I'm going to make some effort? And you can say, okay, I'll make some effort. I believe it's worth it. And then you'll make a lot of progress that way. And you just whittle it down, erode it, gradual erosion. You gradually erode this crazy, whimsical complex that is all twisted up and upside down and convoluted. And there is nothing that can prevent you from dropping your fear of God. Nothing can prevent you. The world can't prevent it. No thought, no belief, no construct. There's nothing that can prevent it. Only you can prevent it by being lazy. That's it. That's only temporary, because eventually you'll decide, I'm going to stop being lazy. And that's what I was told at the very beginning, saying, I was shown what could be done, and then I walked away from it, and I got this feeling of like, are you walking away because it's you can't do it, or are you walking away because you're lazy? And instantly I realized this, because I was lazy. I was thinking, maybe I'll have a lazy life. And then I said, no way, forget it. I don't want to waste this life, so I'm going to take it on. And that's it. Why waste a life? I mean, it's miserable here. Life sucks, and then you die. That's it. So why waste your life in laziness, when instead you can put right effort and persevere and realize the bliss of non-judgment and be free of dreams. Be free of dreams forever, forever, forever free of all dreaming, really. And dreams certainly free of the nightmare that we have cooked up based on the fear of God. We can dream a happy dream based on no fear of God as a continuity device, absolutely. But certainly the nightmares are over forever. All simply from not being lazy and making right effort. That's it. And we keep thinking we can hide from God by dying and hide in the afterlife. No. We'll find ourselves digging deeper into death, trying to bury ourselves under death, trying to hide from God, thinking that God must be furious with us. It's simply not true. God has never paid any attention to our dreams. Not knowing that they're totally meaningless. Totally meaningless. So we're in this time now, time frame. We're like the end times, the times of tribulation, which is why I have these atomic clouds behind me, as it were, because we really are entering the tribulation time. That is very, very true. We're entering the time of collapse, of turmoil, of all these things. And yet we're also entering the time of what you might say miracles, our great opportunity, where there can be those in the world actually who are free of dreaming, free of dreams. Dreams don't touch them. They know that the reality isn't touched by dreams. God is not touched by dreams. God has perfect non-judgment on all dreams. And that is this steady bliss. And there is access to that. And then there is access to those who want to continue on the spiritual path. They will have options. So it's a time of a great time. Really the best of times. Worst of times, best of times. Most definitely. Most definitely. And so what purpose is it to indulge in all the news and all the happenings and stuff? We know it's all taking place. It's all going down. But again, no judgment from God on anything, any content of dreams. None. What if we could realize that God's never paid the slightest bit of attention to all our craziness and has merely been, merely looking at us, seeing us rather, seeing us as we've always been in reality, and is not slightest bit fooled by any of our dreaming? That'd be a pretty great realization, wouldn't it? And yet that's what we have within us. We have that realization. It's just waiting there, just there. It's already there for us. And again, it's the simplest of simple situations of simply accepting it. Nothing we need to do. It's already there. We just need to accept it. 100%. All it is just accepting what's already there. And then the content of dreams doesn't make any difference to us. So we are on the cusp of that. We're on the cusp of various situations, actually. The rumblings are being felt, most definitely. I can say that I'm far along now, very far along. And yet, also, the situation in the world is very far along, too. Very far along. And the two kind of are coinciding. And I've already seen that I'm certainly going to be saved. And this is the time, right around now. This time is the time, and everything is tracking that way for sure. And those of you who can settle in with this type of teaching, and that's a very good sign for you. Not worrying about what do we need to do? Who do we need to fight? What side are we on? All this stuff. God's not on any side of dreams. Not on any side at all. Just non-judgment. No judgment on dreams. All equally meaningless. Just knowing that the dreamer is the same, flawless, perfect. We don't even have a... Words fail, really. We say love and things like that, but it's... That too fails. We don't have the quality of assurance that in dreams we don't have anything that is the same as how it feels in reality. We don't. All we have is a faint memory. But we don't have this experience in dreams at all. Except for the hypothetical of what if we didn't need hypotheticals, which reflects reality. And that gives then the bliss of non-judgment. We don't have the bliss of non-judgment in dreams, as it were, except for the one dream of not needing to dream. Dream of non-judgment. But all other dreams don't have that feeling. So we can't really describe it or explain it. Cannot. It simply has to be experienced. And nobody can explain it to someone else how it feels, because we'll put it into the wrong context. How does non-judgment of all dreams, how does that feel? How can we put that into context of dreams? You know, it's I feel very confident that this is right on track, and very confident the world is very much off track. And that doesn't matter. The world can, dreams can dream whatever they want to dream. Dreams can be whatever. Doesn't matter. Doesn't affect the dreamer. That's all that's important. Doesn't affect the dreamer. So all we need is reassurance that dreams don't affect the dreamer, and what fear do we have of dreams anymore? And this is certainly the teaching for the times. Moving towards affirmation. For instance, with this faces, moving towards affirmations now is concurrent with time. This is the root, one of the root Maha Mantras, great affirmations. Now is concurrent with time, meaning non-judgment was concurrent with, you might say, judgment. The now moment was concurrent with time. At the same instant, not before and not after. And this basically demolishes the fear of God, because it's really the core fear we have is a fear of continuity, fear that there's a lack of continuity, fear that there's a gap. Fear that God is somehow angry, stupid, not competent. Fear of God, basically. But when we realize that the wisdom and the perfection of concurrency with non-judgment, how could God pass non-judgment on dreams before dreams ever arose? How is that possible? Why would God do that? That would be incompetent. And then passing non-judgment on dreams after dreams arose, that too would be incompetent and seemingly an attack or something. But concurrently, that's a different story. That's a whole different story. As soon as you see that it was concurrent, the fear of God evaporates. Now, you maybe go back into habitual mode for a little while, but I can say for sure when I saw that, my core fear of God evaporated. And I said, well done, perfectly done. That's exactly the way it had to be done. And I got no problem with that whatsoever, none. I said, I could address God directly saying, God, I have no problem whatsoever with the concurrency. He did exactly the right thing, and I'm very happy to know that now, finally. It was concurrent. All is forgiven. It was perfectly done. So that core fear evaporated. And then from that point, I've just been moving rapidly towards accepting a vision of non-judgment, experience of the bliss of non-judgment. Feeling very nervous, though, I guess, as one would expect. The times are fraught with peril, really. The world is really coming a cropper. There's no question about it. And there's a lot of stuff going on. And so, and of course, as the fear of God is brought up to the surface entirely, there's going to be a little bit of jitters and nervousness. But that is what I'm doing. I'm bringing it to the surface, into the light, entirely. So there is some nervous strain, absolutely. That's entirely to be expected. The spiritual path is a strain. It's a nervous strain because we are dealing with this root, deep, deep-seated, and reinforced fear, dread, terror. So of course it's a strain. It's difficult. The spiritual path is difficult. That's why we say that one must persevere. Jesus said that he who persevereth to the end shall be saved. Persevering means, generally it means that you keep going in spite of difficulties. You keep making your way, even though the fear keeps dogging you. I had a fearful dream last night, really fearful dream. I was going down into some basement some underground area, some area beneath the surface. I was going down beneath the surface, and there were these two pit bulls there. And I thought they were guarding the area, and I thought they were going to attack me. So I pulled myself out of there, and I was frightened. And then later in the dream, the pit bulls were with me, and they were all super friendly to me and happy, and I realized they weren't vicious or dangerous at all. That I had set them there to try to scare myself away from entering to what's beneath the surface, beneath the superficial, beneath the form, and getting to actual content, which is really non-judgment. And the dogs were just completely friendly dogs, actually. I said, wow, why was I afraid of them? But I'd forgotten that I had put them there. So that was a very frightening dream. And we place all these obstacles in to scare ourselves away. And we've forgotten that we placed them there. And as we go back, end up being very, very supportive and friendly to us, because they don't really want to be there. And when you forgive God, then the all this ferocious guardians, they've turned into very mellow, very friendly creatures. I had a situation, a dream again with like a lion, I think. A ferocious lion, and the lion, oh, I know, I was like out in the jungle, savannah somewhere, and there's this lion staring at me super intently, and I thought, oh, I'm going to be jumped, and I'm going to be attacked and devoured. And then the lion, when I just kept looking at it, very quietly looking at the lion lay down with a look of bliss on its face, and just sat there very blissful. And I said, wow. The lion lies down with the lamb, as it were. I said, holy cow, I thought I was going to be destroyed. Instead, it's just the opposite. So, certainly, the rapid progress is due to the use of this Maha Mantra now is concurrent with time. I've been using that, and that has really empowered the whole situation to a vast extent. But, of course, it also is based on decades of effort too. But whenever you can grab a hold of a powerful affirmation, by all means use it as much as possible, and you will find dramatic steps forward. Actually, and you'll have these signature dreams, these signature moments where what previously seemed to be insurmountable or terrifying suddenly is transformed. A ferocious lion about to devour you lies down and is completely friendly and blissful and super peaceful. And you realize the lion could never be anything other than super peaceful. Situations like that. You will have situations like that. And then you know that there's a transformation of your inner landscape is taking place. And you may not know it at the time, but it's really you're losing your fear of God is what is happening. And we don't have to keep up this masquerade of faces, okay? Absolutely don't have to keep up this masquerade of the fear of God, all based on our desire to be God, to replace God. Because this is a very desolate path, masquerading path of fear, very desolate. We can put a grin on our face, sure. Everybody tries to put some kind of grin on their face. But who are we fooling? It's only superficial. It's the form. We try to manipulate the form. Say, hey, I'm flashing my pearly whites. I'm smiling. Everything's great within, but then when you look at how you feel within, there's this vast, terrible dread. Fear of God is in massive defensiveness against it, and all sorts of tricks and strategies, etc. So the issue isn't try to appear to be happy form-wise. It's to look within and begin to evaporate that fear. Keep evaporating the fear. And again, I'm simply encouraging everyone to continue this because absolutely it's working in my case. Simply continued perseverance, continued effort. Use of the Maha Mantra. Now is concurrent with time. The peace of God is mine. Now is concurrent with time. What can disturb God's peace? Nothing. God's peace cannot be disturbed. And what God has is also mine. So the peace of God is mine. Peace of God is mine. The undisturbedness is mine. Dreams can't disturb the peace of God. Everything that God created shared. Everything that God is shared with all of God's creation. So the peace of God is also ours. And dreams cannot disturb that. Now is concurrent with time. The peace of God is mine. I accept God's perfect non-judgment upon all dreams. Just talk in that way if you can. Talk in the way of affirmations. Just use affirmations. Just use those. And you'll find that the speed of your path is like quantum speed compared to other ways. And we certainly need quantum speed at this time. Again, don't pay attention to the news. I last couple of days I've been looking at it for some reason because of there are certain signs that are showing up now that indicate it really is so close. But that's also increased my nervousness, and it's not a good idea really to indulge in that. Because there's so much going on, it pulls one into more and more and more and more and more and more and more, because it's just heating up. Again, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter, because help is on its way. The best help in this world is those who encourage us to use affirmations. That's the best help, and it show us the result of that. The no fear of God at all. Those who are in the world who have no fear of God. And they encourage us to use affirmations. That's the great help. The big boost, as I like to call it. That's certainly on its way very soon. And I've been frantically acclimatizing myself to that opportunity and inviting everybody else to do the same. Keep acclimatizing yourself. Keep moving your base camp up higher and higher and higher up the mountain so you can climb to the top of the mountain when it's necessary. When the opportunity is there, when the clouds break, when the weather's good, climb to the top of the mountain, get it done. Lose your fear of God, set it down. It's silly, it's useless, it's meaningless. There are those who have done it, and you most certainly will do it all as well. I most certainly will do it. You will too. We'll all do it. And there's some who have already done it. And now is a great time to do it. Don't want to keep postponing it. Procrastination. Procrastination is not a good thing right now. It's really not. How can we strike a better deal than perfect non-judgment? There is no better deal. That is perfect. But the perfect deal has always been there. So why not take the perfect deal? It will always be the perfect deal. It's not going to get any better. Not going to get any worse. It's always exactly perfect non-judgment. It will always be that. So there's really no reason to wait on it. So, here we go, heading into the last week the last part of March 2013, which is a very consequential time, actually. You can probably feel it. You can probably feel it's on. It is really on. It's all coming to pass. Everything's coming to pass that we know is slated to come to pass. It's all right now at our doorstep. So we have to make a step of faith and say, you know what? I'm sure that I can set down the fear of God. I'm sure it can be done. I know there's help. I know there's encouragement. I don't need to worry about this other stuff. I was always told, don't worry about the world. Don't worry what's going to happen. Forget about it. It's not, for you, it's not important. It's not relevant. Take that attitude. It's simply, for you, is not relevant. Simply is not relevant. Whatever comes, whatever comes, you will be taken care of. The grace of God will take care of you because you're accepting of it. You're willing to accept it because you know you're accepting where it's going to lead you. It's going to lead you to the bliss of non-judgment, which then solves a continuity problem, which then allows us to set down all dreaming altogether. So you know it'll lead you there. So just trust it. Just trust it and don't be afraid. And don't worry about the fate of the world. Why worry about the fate of dreams? If you wake up in the morning and say, oh my gosh, I got to go back to sleep because there was this dream, there was this tsunami coming in and I got to find out what happened. I had a dream last night of all the tide, the ocean sucked out. And I said, oh my gosh, there's only one thing that can cause the ocean to be sucked out like that and lay the ocean floor bare. It's a tsunami coming. And I said, I better get the heck out of here. And then I woke up from it. And do I say, okay, I got to go back to sleep and find out what happened. Did I get away from it? Or did the tsunami come in or whatever? It's like that. Our dreams are so seemingly consequential. We want to keep on dreaming to find out what happens or to make sure that we escape from it. But really, dreams are not consequential at all. We don't have to find out what happens in dreams. So it doesn't matter what happens to the world. None of it matters at all. So we should take that attitude. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter at all. And therefore, we don't have to be experts on what's happening. Try to refrain from becoming an expert on what is happening. Which is why I'm suggesting using affirmations, and whenever your mind starts to go off on a tangent, now say, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Use that, and that will acclimatize you to bliss. It'll actually acclimatize you to bliss, which is where you really want to go. All right. So let's keep on going. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And this, the background music you hear is by Saregama. I think the tune is called Himalayan. All right, we'll finish this up with some music and this. Let's do the Maha Mantra with the faces.